Hello, I'm Nathan, and welcome to the third part of our Appian app build. In the last episode, we started off our build by setting up our records, views, and actions using the Appian data fabric. And today I'm going to take you through the next stage of building our app, sites and user interfaces for our business users. Now, we've already built some basic interfaces for things like record summaries and record lists, but now we're going to think about the user experience and bring those interfaces together in a way that works for our business users. First up, we're going to need to create a site, which is where you can provide users with a customized and focused experience to quickly access pages, tasks, and information needed for their role. So we'll start off by setting the object name and then the display name, which is how it's going to look to the users within their browser. And then the web address identifier and description can all be set as well if need be. And of course, we'll set the object security at this stage too. Now, sites have two key parts that we need to configure: the pages and the content wrap into one, and the branding as well. So let's start off with the pages, and fairly simple flow here being called out. We can click into add page. We can give that page a name, and we can change the icon as well to something a bit more relevant. And at this point, we can either use an existing interface or create a new one. Now, what I want here is a dashboard style view for these users. So I'm going to click this plus button to create a new interface and call it Relocation Dashboard. And you'll notice there's this option here to include in design library. If you're not familiar with the design library objects, check out release 23.1. There's more details in there, but in short, you've now got the ability to save an interface as a design object for easy reuse elsewhere. So you could design a standard navigation or a key set of KPIs that you could use across multiple interfaces. And they'll then appear here in this design library tab on the palette. Now, when it comes to building interfaces, hopefully you're familiar with the palette. You can drag in your own components, you can drag in different patterns, and if you want to see how those patterns can be used, it's worth checking out design.appian.com. Loads of great inspiration on there on how to design beautiful interfaces using those. But you can also use these template styles over on the right hand side for layouts, but also example templates that have been pre-built for you to work with. And I'm actually going to do that and use landing page 2 as my base to work from. Now, this example fits our purpose fairly well, and a few simple changes here will make this fit our needs. So remember, this is going to be a landing page for users, the business users, to request office relocations. So they're going to want to be able to raise those requests and view the progress of them as well. So let's first of all change some of the wording here. Let's change this rich text box at the top to say request your office move. And we'll just take out this text underneath for now. That call to action button, not really relevant for us, but we do want a nice clear call to action for our users. So let's delete that and pull in a record action button and drop that in. Again, it's fairly easy to go through and configure this and link it to the record actions that we created in the last video. So we can, first of all, add in the new action and look up our action button from, or sorry, our action from our previous record. So if we just search OR request, and then we can select the action to create a new request. And that button's currently looking a little bit lost. That previous one that was on the template was nice and bold and clear. So let's go and change that to being a call to action button. There we go. So a lot more bold and easy to see where our attention is drawn. Now, one final change that I want to make here is to enable the user raising their request to track the progress of their existing requests if they come back to this page at a later date. So let's drop this whole floor plans section. We'll just delete that column. And let's drag in a read-only grid. And let's point that to our requests record. So again, if we just look up our relocation request record that we created in the last episode, we can drop that in there. and then any request that's been generated will be visible there. Now, the reality is we would probably only want to see the requests that we ourselves have raised. So we can apply filtering on the top of this. And in fact, we'll do this in a later episode when we start to look at how we can limit the information that people are seeing relevant to their role. So in this case, I would only want to see the requests I've made. That's coming up in a later episode. But in the interests of tidying up the UI a little bit, let's get rid of that label read-only grid. It doesn't really fit with what we're doing here. We could just rename it to being my requests, but then that's not in keeping with the rest of the layout here. So what I'm actually going to do is take this rich text and copy it, drop that in as a header for this particular column, and then we can rename that and change the content to say something like my relocations or my requests, like so. And there we go. That's now looking a bit more on par with the rest of the screen there. We can also change things like those columns and things like the new request button. It's a bit superfluous to have that button in there twice. So coming into the grid, we can take out any of those record actions that we don't need. We can also change any of the columns on there. So let's get rid of the button. We don't need that. And with the columns, let's go and filter down some of those. So maybe we don't need things like the modified fields on there. We can drop those ones off like so. And maybe for things like the assignee, we want to show it in another way. Maybe we want to show a picture of the user. So if we click into that assignee, we can come into display options, and then we can change that to being a user image. And there we go, my wonderful mugshot there showing instead. Things like employee, we can then also tidy that up as well and show the employee name, i.e. my name, rather than my ID code. But a couple of simple changes like that, and we can start to make that interface look a lot more visual. So let's hit save changes and come back into our site. Okay, so we now have our page within our site, and you can see, just like in the data fabric record creation on the last episode, we start to get this spider diagram showing us the relationship between our pages and subpages as well. But let's just hit save and go and have a look at how this site looks. So we should now see a site. So we should now see a site visible when we click through this link. There we go. So all of those changes that we just made on that template are now showing on this site. But it's set at the default colors at this stage, and that might not be the branding colors that we have. So let's go and make a few more edits here within the branding preview section. So first of all, we can change a few things like the buttons. Let's make them semi-rounded. And let's put in an accent color that's relevant to our company's brand. So we can override the hex code here. We can also use the picker and change the colors based on a color selection, but this allows you to align nice and closely with your company's branding. And then things like our selection, we can set that as well. And then our company logo, I'm just going to reuse a logo from an existing file, like so. And then our header color as well, which was that big blue bar across the top. Let's change that one too. Okay, so let's hit save on there and go and refresh our site. And there we go. We've got our company co logo up there. We've got the bold blue color. The buttons are all more rounded, the input boxes are rounded. So a couple of simple tweaks there, but we've made that interface pop that little bit more. So let's go and test it. Let's hit that new request button and see how this works. So we brought into the forms that are associated with that actions button. So in our previous episode, we went through the stages of creating a record action. This is the result of that record action. So we've got the ability to fill out our form here and submit or create that new request. But there's a few things here that we maybe want to change. If you remember from that previous episode, there's some user experience things that could be better. So things like priority, it's a free text field at the minute, which is okay, but we might want that to be a dropdown. The assignee, we probably want that to be pre-populated. We don't want those end users selecting it. Likewise with status, we don't want to be setting that. We want that to automatically be created for us. And also, it just seems very wide. Do we need a widescreen view? Especially since we're looking at this on a widescreen monitor, do we need all of this real estate to be taken up? So there's a few things that we could change here to make that look a little bit friendlier. So let's go back to our interface objects within the main library, and we're going to need to track down the interface for creating or updating a request and open that within the interface designer. So let's filter down to interfaces, and we should then see create or update request. Quick preview just to check that's the form. It is. Great. Let's open that up. So a few things. Let's change our notes to being a paragraph because we need to type a bit more space there, and we'll link that through to the notes field within the record. So, and call that notes. We can delete that one from the form. We're also going to need to specify where the offices are. We're going to need that to be a required field. So let's turn those to be required. Great. And then status and assignee, we'll just set those as hidden for now, or remove them completely, in fact. So let's just take those ones off. Perfect. Okay, so a couple of simple changes there. Let's maybe change the employee to be over on the right-hand side here. So that's tucked out of the way. And then for our priority and move date, we can just pop those pieces in side by side so they're not taking up as much space. There we go. And hit save. The last thing then ties back to how big that form was when we hit that record action button. So for that, we'll need to go into our record and adjust how that pop-up will look or how that modal will look. So if we come back into the record itself and under our actions, we can change our new request action and set our dialog box size a little bit smaller. So let's go to medium and save that. So now let's again go back to our site. Let's do a refresh there and hit that new request button. There we go. That looks a lot tidier, a lot easier to work with as well. So let's do a quick test. Let's do an office move from 123 Main Street to 130 New Street. And hit create. And there we go. We see our new information, our new request added in the bottom there. Now there's some fields that aren't populated because we've removed them from that form. We can certainly set that form to pre-populate the information and default that information. We'll cover that in another episode where we get more into the detail around using an expression editor for setting fields with default values behind the scenes, so to speak, without the users having to see them. But we now know at least that information is still being written after the changes that we've made to the interface. So to recap, we've created a site for our business users to land on for raising requests. We've enabled them to view their existing requests and the status of those requests. We've edited the create request form to be a little bit cleaner and require less data entry. And in episode 4, we're going to dive into the world of process and take a look at how we can automatically populate some of those fields like status and assignee, as well as build a workflow for other teams to help progress this office relocation request through the workflow. Don't forget to like and subscribe for more great content like this. Drop a comment below if you have any questions. Otherwise, I'll see you on the next video.